to know the Lord. I'm trying to imagine what my life would really be like if I didn't know the Lord, if I had never committed my life to Him and I just kind of lived my own life, my own way, how empty that would be, how unfulfilling that would be. It is amazing what God has done for us. Okay, so we're looking at the word of wisdom starting in, I'm going to have quite a few scriptures here today, 1 Corinthians 12:8. And you might want to have a pen to jot down some of these scripture verses. But we've been looking at this in the context of the spiritual gifts. And starting in verse 7, we looked first of all last week at wisdom. Wisdom is a spiritual gift. Of all the spiritual gifts, Paul mentions this one first. And in verse 7, he says, "Now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good." And in one line, one phrase, if you need to understand what the gifts are given for the body of Christ, it's for the common good. It's not just for you individually, although the gifts that God gives us is a tremendous blessing for us. It helps us. It builds us up. But it's also for the common good. It's mainly for the body. The gift that God gives you is a blessing, not only for yourself, but for those around you. It is that light. When Jesus said, to let that light inside of you shine so that it would benefit and bless the others. And we are part of using that gift to benefit the rest of the body of Christ. And people will be glad as you are operating and working in that gift. People are going to be glad because you have come around, because you are ministering to the body, ministering to people at work, ministering to people in the family, the light of Christ. Jesus said, "If I be lifted up, I will draw all men to myself." And as we are fulfilling the plan and the purpose that God has for us, as we are living and operating in the gifts that He's given to us, it is going to lift up Christ. And that's why Jesus said, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." So you have an opportunity to be a blessing to all the people around you as you operate in those gifts. And you remember the story of the man with the talents and the one who hid his talent. Why in the world would he hide his talent? Now, Jesus used that. And one of the definitions would be as using the gifts. He gave it to each man according to his ability, Jesus said. And he hid that talent. And I believe the reason he hid that talent was because of fear. You know, he was afraid of rejection. He was afraid of whatever it would be that if I use this gift, if I put it to work, if I put it to use, somehow it's not going to be accepted, it's going to be rejected. Most of us deal with the fear of rejection. I know, you know, when I was in high school, I mean, I was so shy. I would hate to ask girls for a date. And so most of the time, I never asked girls for a date. You know, I like somebody, I want to spend some time with them, but I'm so afraid to ask them out because I might get rejected. Okay, so what happens is that benefit, that blessing, whatever it might be in your life, if you're afraid of rejection and you don't step out, then you do without. You don't receive the blessing of that. And so the man who hid his gift at the end, he had nothing to show for it. He never put it to work. He buried it instead of letting it be like a light. And so all of us have been blessed in the body of Christ with gifts. And as we put it to work, it's going to bless us, it's going to glorify God, and it's going to minister to those around them. All right, verse 8. He says, "To one there is given through the Spirit the word of wisdom." And so we've been looking at the word of wisdom that comes from God. If everybody fully develops their gift, nothing will be missing, nothing will be lacking in the body of Christ. It will be like heaven on earth, because whatever we need, God is going to bless us with through the entire body. And I used a few of the illustrations last week. George Washington Carver, talking about God's little workshop. He was a godly, godly man, and he would take just the Bible. He would take a notebook. He wouldn't take any scientific books with him. He was a scientist. He was a professor, but he would go, and he would just spend time with God, and God would open up these secret areas of wisdom and understanding. And Brad Mayhew was sharing after church with me, he had studied in school about George Washington Carver, and he had this great, great pull quote that I want to share with you about that. You see, George Washington Carver was brilliant, brilliant man and scientist. And so he's there asking God to show him the secrets of the universe. And God said to him, you know, affectionately, he said, "Little man, your puny mind cannot contain the secrets of the universe. But I will show you the secret of the peanut." Instead of the universe, he's going to give him a peanut. Now, if I was trying to uncover all the secrets and all the uses for a peanut, I'd probably come up with peanut butter, peanut oil. I mean, I'd start be running out. You know, can you imagine God showing him all these secrets and he finds five secrets? I would have been doing handstands or 10 secrets, 12 inventions from the peanut. Could you imagine getting 50 different inventions from a little peanut? Over 100, 200, 300 plus inventions from a little peanut? Uses? Unbelievable. God said, "I'll just show you one. How about a peanut? We'll start with a peanut. We'll show you that." And God just opens up the doors. That is the wisdom of God, showing us things that we could never know or understand by ourselves. All of us know who Sir Isaac Newton is, considered one of the greatest mathematicians that had ever lived. I mean, absolutely genius, brilliant. And what you might not know about Isaac Newton is that he wrote more commentaries on the Bible than he did about mathematics. Think about where he got all of this understanding, all of this wisdom from. It wasn't coming from him. It was coming from the Lord his God, who was teaching him not only about the scripture, but about the world around him. That's why Kepler said that as we study the sciences, it's not in opposition to the Bible. It's actually in correlation with the Bible. He says we're studying God's thoughts after him. God can open us up the wisdoms of the heavens. The Bible says that the heavens declare the glory of God. And so as we apply ourselves to the Lord, he can teach us, he can show us, he can give us wisdom. And I'll share one more story with you. It's a man by the name of R.G. Littoral. Now, he had a big company. It was kind of like a earth-moving equipment. This is something like Caterpillar. Well, as the beginning of World War II, the government approached him because they needed ships. You know, all the ships that were sunk at Pearl Harbor and the German U-boats, they were sinking all the American ships, and they needed a company to build ships. And they were hoping that he could build a ship every 30 to 45 days. And so they converted all their plants. They're going to start building these ships. And they would build the hulls upside down. Now, the problem they were having was that as they began to turn them right side up, the rivets would pop, and they were having problems manufacturing these ships. And so what R.G. Littoral did is that he fasted. Now, one of the ways that you can get the wisdom of God is through fasting, to slow your system down, to get in tune with God. How many of us have a problem just to be still long enough so God can speak to our hearts? And so he fasted one day, 2 days. He fasted 3 days, and on the fourth day of his fast, God spoke to him about the shipbuilding. And when God revealed to him the way that he was supposed to build those ships, he didn't build a ship every 30 days or every 20 days, not every 10 days. They built a ship a day. He showed them how to build a ship. I mean, if I built a ship in a day, it'd probably sink. But he was building these ships every single day. God showed him the process, helped America in the war effort. That's how God can use those gifts. How about in your life? You see, God can show you things where you work, at home. The wisdom is available to all in the body of Christ because the Spirit of God gives us that wisdom, gives us that understanding. There's not a problem that you're facing today that if you did not have the wisdom of God, He could open up the door, He could show you a new way, He could show you things that would help you where your problem is today, the things that you're going through today. And so God has that available to the body of Christ. Now, when we talk about the gift of wisdom, I think the greatest illustration of that is Solomon. And we talked about Solomon last week, that he was a young man. He is made king over Israel. And God came to him and said, I'll give you one wish. Whatever you want. Came to him in a dream. What would you like me to give you? And he wanted to have understanding and wisdom to be able to govern this great people that God had blessed him with, the people of Israel. God was so pleased that he asked for wisdom and not for fame or fortune or the death of his enemies or long life or anything else. He said, I'm going to give you what you asked for. I'm going to make you the wisest man that ever lived. And then I'm going to give you what you didn't ask for, and blessed him to be one of the richest men that ever lived. And let me just read a couple scriptures. In 1 Kings chapter 4, it talks about the wisdom that God gave him. 1 Kings 4:29. It says, God gave Solomon wisdom and very great insight and breadth of understanding as measureless as the sands of the seashore. Solomon's wisdom was greater than the wisdom of all the men of the East and greater than all the wisdom of Egypt. In verse 33, it says that he described plant life and the cedars of Lebanon to the hyssops that grows out of the wall. He also taught about animals and birds, reptiles and fish. Men of all nations came to listen to Solomon's wisdom, sent by all the kings of the world who had heard of his wisdom. So God's given him all this wisdom about the sciences and about nature and about plant life and about the animals. And this wisdom is so great that the secular world started coming to him. Kings were hearing about this, other nations, and they're sending emissaries to come and to talk to Solomon to gain that. You see, as God begins to glorify himself, wherever God is manifesting himself, God is going to draw people to himself. He's going to glorify himself, and he wants to glorify himself through the body of Christ. He wants to glorify himself through us, his children. And so we have got to be vessels that are open to God that he might be able to manifest his gifts through us. Let me just read one more scripture on that in 1 Kings chapter 10. This is a great picture, I believe, of not only God's gift to Solomon, but it's really kind of a, to me, it's like heaven on earth, seeing how God's wisdom is displayed in such a way that it really magnifies God himself in his kingdom. And this is about the Queen of Sheba. And it says, and she was from Ethiopia, by the way, and she makes this long travel. I don't know how many months it would take with these camels and these caravans to come there, but it was a very dangerous trip, and she took her life in her hands. But it says, when the Queen of Sheba heard about the fame of Solomon in his relation to the name of the Lord. You see, God was being glorified through Solomon, through the gift that God had given Solomon. So much so, she came to test him with hard questions. And so it will drive people hundreds and thousands of miles if they know that they can find the true and living God. Whatever it might be, God will draw people from all different corners to be blessed by it, to be ministered by it. No matter where you're at, God will draw people around you if you are manifesting the Spirit and the power of God. So she comes, she's going to give him these hard questions. All right, God, we're going to see just how smart you really are. Arriving at Jerusalem with a very great caravan, with camels carrying spices, large quantities of gold and precious stones, she came to Solomon and talked to him about all that she had on her mind. Solomon answered all her questions. Nothing was too hard for the king to explain to her. When the queen of Sheba saw all the wisdom of Solomon and the palace he had built, the food on his table, the settings of his officials, the attendants serving in their robes, his cupbearers, and the burnt offerings he made at the temple of the Lord, she was overwhelmed, the Bible says. Overwhelmed. She'd come this great distance, and it's like when you go to see a movie that you've been really hyped up about it, and you're so excited about it, and you're all thinking about it, and you're disappointed. Didn't meet the hype. This not only met the hype, it exceeded. It overwhelmed her. And so she says to the king, "The report I heard in my own country about your achievements and your wisdom is true. Everything that I heard is absolutely true. But I did not believe these things until I came and saw them with my own eyes. Indeed, not even half was told me. In wisdom and wealth, you have far exceeded the report I heard." I want you to take that as a small picture of what heaven's going to be like. We've heard all the stories, and people with near-death experiences, you can't put into words what the colors and what the music and everything is like up in heaven. And you know what? When we get to heaven, it won't even begin to scratch the surface of the reality of God, His love, and His wisdom. See, I think this is like a small little picture of what heaven is going to be like. It's like heaven here on earth. She has been overwhelmed. How happy your men must be. How happy your officials who continually stand before you and hear your wisdom. Praise be to the Lord your God, who has delighted in you and placed you on a throne of Israel. Because of the Lord's eternal love for Israel, He has made you king to maintain justice and righteousness. That's one of the things that happens. When God is blessing His body, it causes people to become happy, to become joyful, to have peace in their heart. It says in Ecclesiastes that wisdom brightens a man's face and changes its hard appearance. When God comes through and He answers in a special way and He ministers to your need, it brings joy to your heart. Whenever you're going through a struggle or a trial in your life and God comes through, what does it make you? It makes you happy, makes you joyful, gives you peace in your heart. Let me just read one more sentence, verse 10. This really caught my attention. And she gave the king 120 talents of gold, large quantities of spices and precious stones. Never again were so many spices brought in as those that the queen of Sheba gave to the king of Solomon. 120 talents of gold. That's got to be a pretty big bag, right? 120 talents is the equivalent to 4.5 tons. 4.5 tons of gold. Now, you get a gold bar, and it's running around 1,000-plus an ounce. You multiply that by 16 to get a pound. You multiply that by 2,000 to get a ton. Then you multiply that by 4.5 to get 4.5 tons of pure gold. I mean, we're talking billions and billions of dollars there. And I'm trying to imagine what kind of caravan is going to carry 4.5 tons of anything. Plus all the spices and all the other stuff. I mean, she had to have a small or large army to carry all of this stuff on these camels. She came because she was so impressed with the wisdom, just the report of what she heard, and it blew her away. That's what I believe, that the body of Christ If we are living the way that God has intended us, He is going to bless us with these gifts, bless us with wisdom. In Jeremiah 10:12, it says, God made the earth by His power. He founded the world by His wisdom and stretched out the heavens with His understanding. When He thunders, the waters in the heavens roar. You see, you cannot look at creation. If you are a born-again, believing Christian, the Spirit of God lives in you, you look at the creation and you see it with new eyes. You say, this is absolutely unbelievable that God has created all of this. But for those who are darkened in their hearts and minds, it says in Psalms 53 that the fool says in his heart, there is no God. It's all a mistake. It's all just an explosion. Really? That's how it all happened? Sure, a big explosion. That's obvious, right? Yeah, I mean, it's absolutely unbelievable to believe the craziness of what the world's going to teach you about the origins of life, because they don't want you to know that there really is a God, that He is on His throne. And if we, His children, like the Queen of Sheba, when we get to heaven, not only are we going to be enveloped by God's love that is just going to overwhelm us, I believe we are going to also be enveloped with the wisdom of God. Our minds are going to be able to see and understand things that are absolutely going to blow us away, and I believe it'll just continue to increase for all eternity. Our minds will probably, I can't imagine what eternity would be like and how long that's going to be, but if you can imagine how long eternity could be and you could still keep growing for all eternity and never exhaust the wisdom and the love of God, imagine what that's going to be like. A lot of people, believe me, there's one word that will not be in the dictionary, in the vocabulary of heaven, and that word is bored. Oh, I am so bored. No, you're not going to be bored in heaven. Every moment is going to be absolutely unbelievable. It is going to be to the full, above and beyond all that we could ask or think. When the love and gifts of God are being fully expressed in the body of Christ, I believe it is like heaven on earth. This is as close as we'll get to heaven on earth when the body of Christ is doing what God has created it to do. There's not another institution on the planet, not an institution of learning, not a sports, not arts, not anything else that matches what God has established when Jesus created the church. He said, upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. All right, let's look at the second point, the word. God first gives us wisdom, then He gives us His word. How do we receive the wisdom of God? Wisdom comes from God's word and from God's spirit. That's where the wisdom comes from. In Proverbs chapter 1, it talks about wisdom and knowing the wisdom of God. And so if you want to turn there, verses 1 through 7. Let me find it here. Okay, it says, the Proverbs of Solomon, son of David, king of Israel, for attaining wisdom and discipline, for understanding words of insight, for acquiring a disciplined and prudent life, doing what is right, just, and fair, for giving prudence to the simple, knowledge and discretion to the young, for the wise listening, listen and add to their learning. And let the discerning get guidance for understanding proverbs and parables, the sayings and riddles of the wise. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and discipline. One of the ways that we receive the wisdom of God is through the Word of God. There is so much contained in His Word that it's going to open, that is going to enlighten, that is going to bless our lives. You know, it said of Jesus that when He was born in Luke 2:52, it says that He grew in wisdom, in stature, in favor with God and man. Jesus himself, as he grew as a child, his wisdom was expanding in his earthly man. And it continued to expand his entire life while he was here on earth. And God gave him the wisdom that he needed to fulfill all the plans that he had. Jesus himself said, "You shall know the truth, and the truth will" what? It sets you free. When you get understanding, when you get enlightenment in an area of your life, what it does is it begins to set you free. It liberates you from the bondage of the darkness and the ignorance that you may have been living in. And so all of that is for the body of Christ. Now, when we talk about the Word of God, let me just give you two words, Greek words, about the Word. The first one is the word logos, and that is simply the written word. When the Greek talks about the logos, it talks about the written word. And so from the written word, there is wisdom and knowledge. This is what Joshua said. Our God said to Joshua in Joshua 1:8, he says, "Do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything that is written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful." Is there anyone in this room who does not want to be prosperous and successful? We all desire those things in our lives. But how do you get it? Well, he says, first, do not let the book of this law depart from your mouth. The things that you think about, the things that you talk about, the things that are on your heart. Jesus said, out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. So as the word is in your mouth, and then he said, meditate upon it. Take that word, think it over, ruminate, let it sink deep into your soul, into your spirit. When you're talking about it, when you're meditating on it, you know what eventually happens? The actions happen. He says, and be careful to do what it says. Then you'll do what it says. And then, at the end of that, he says, then you will be prosperous and successful. Because God knows where to lead you. God knows the plans that he has for our life. And as we're following him, he's going to open up the doors. He's going to get us to the right place. God has shown us the way that our life can be a blessing and not a terror here in this world. And so the written word needs to be a part of our daily lives. And the second word I want to share with you is the word rhema. That's where you get the idea of revelation. God opening up his Holy Spirit. He takes the logos, the written word, and he illuminates it to our heart. He gives us revelation. He gives us understanding. He reveals the word to us. It's like the word begins to jump off the page and smacks us in the head. You know, it's kind of the aha, or it's like the epiphany that you get. I mean, there's just this incredible enlightenment that happens as God begins to reveal himself to you through his word or through prayer, through the Holy Spirit. Let me share a story with you to kind of illustrate that. My parents, my dad was a farmer. He grew fresh herbs. And I mean, this was really the blessing of God. He sold basil to Publix. And Publix, that's a pretty big company, to sell all that basil. And we first got into the basil market in the early 90s when it was coming of age. God just gave my mom and my dad favor. And so they're selling basil to Publix. Well, one of the things is that, you know, they order a lot. They order tons. Well, they went through a period where I think there was a freeze. It must have been in the like January, February, where there wasn't much basil to be had. Now, my mom, she was the businesswoman. She understood in order to keep the business going, you had to fill the orders. My dad was the farmer, and he knew, you know, what needed to be done to keep that supply going. Well, they were running out of supply, and the demand was way up here. And so I was out there working with them. I was working out in the field, and I remember one day, I'll never forget it. They're about a quarter of a mile away. My mom had come out. My dad was there. had a big order, and they were arguing or talking very loudly. I could hear them almost a quarter mile away. And I'm thinking to myself, what in the world? You know, because this is very unusual. I mean, you know, they've argued before, but I mean, this was really intense. And I'm walking over to the shed to pack the basil that we had collected, and I couldn't for the life of me understand what in the world was getting them so upset. And so what I did, I asked the Lord. He gave me a word of knowledge, and he kind of explained, my mom knows we need to fill these orders, and my dad knows that we don't have the material, we don't have the basil to fulfill them, and we've got to wait 2 or 3 weeks until the stuff that's coming up is big enough, you know, that it was probably about that high, and it needs to be at least 2 or 3 feet high before you cut it, and you cut it too soon, you'll never have enough supply. So that was the problem. And I'm walking there, I'm thinking, wow, so what are we going to do? And so the Lord showed me. He said, there's a place on the market down in Miami that there's basil coming in from South America that we should buy it from them, fill the orders till our basil was ready to do it. And I thought, they'll never go for that. I mean, you know, my dad would never, ever go for that. And so I'm there at the shed, and I said, well, and I'm talking to the Lord. I said, well, Lord, if they ask me, I'm going to tell you, I was kind of shy. If they ask me, I'll tell them. So they come down to the shed, and they're still arguing, and they're going. And finally, my mom looks at me, and she says, so Dan, what do you think we should do? And so I told them. And they said, that's a great idea. And that's what we did. We literally changed our business. Whenever we ran short, we were able to buy stuff to keep the supply till our crops came in. And even if we weren't making much money, we were keeping those orders because you got to feed the big dog. You know what I'm talking about? You got to keep those orders going. And God blessed us. And you know what happened? We were all happy. That's what the Bible says. Wisdom brightens a man's face and it changes its hard appearance. If you had a solution from God for whatever problem you're going through, it's going to make you happy. It's going to brighten your face. And we have that in the Spirit of God. If the Spirit of God is living inside of you, He will reveal, but we've got to diligently seek it like we're seeking a treasure. It's not just there on the surface. We need to spend that time with God so that we can grow. And we need to ask God for the spirit of wisdom and revelation. And I'll share with you, I've shared it before, but one of the prayers that I pray for myself every week in Ephesians 1:17, I'm asking God for exactly that. He says, I keep asking the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, that He may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know Him better. I know that even if I don't know all the answers, I know who's got the answers, and I know where I can seek them and find them. James said that we should ask God for wisdom if we need it. He says in James 1:5, if anyone lacks wisdom, he should call upon God who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. So it is available to everyone in the body of Christ if we seek Him and we ask for it. Let me share with you one last story about godly wisdom, and we'll close there. Now, Nebuchadnezzar in the book of Daniel, he had a dream, and he wanted the answer to this dream, but he didn't want to tell his wise men what the dream was. So he wanted the dream, and he wanted the answer, and he decided, if they can't do that, then I'm going to kill them all. So they couldn't do it. They rounded them up to kill them all. Well, Daniel was a young man. He was born in Jerusalem in Israel, and they were brought into captivity to Babylon, and he was a part of the crew that was going to be killed. King Nebuchadnezzar didn't know Daniel, and he wasn't going to lose any sleep, and he wasn't going to disrupt his dinner at all once all these wise men were killed. But Daniel was a man of God, and he asked the king for some time because he knew where he could get the answer for the king. And so he and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they came and they prayed. And let me pick it up in Daniel 2:17. It says, "Then Daniel returned to his house, explained the matter to his friends, and urged them to plead for mercy from the God of heaven concerning this mystery, so that he and his friends might not be executed with the rest of the wise men in Babylon." Now, I'll guarantee you, whatever trial you're going through right now, whatever tribulation there might be, whatever mountain is in your life right now, probably isn't as bad as what Daniel's going through. He's going to get killed the next day if he doesn't get this answer. And so he is pleading with God to give him the answer. During the night, the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a vision. Then Daniel praised the God of heaven, saying, listen to this, "Praise be to the name of our God forever and ever. Wisdom and power are his. He changes times and seasons. He sets up kings and deposes them. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to the discerning. He reveals deep and hidden things. He knows what lies in darkness, and light dwells with him. I thank and praise you, O God of my fathers. You have given me," what? "Wisdom and power. You have made known to me what we asked of you. You have made known to us the dream of the king." Now let me tell you, when he got that revelation, what do you think happened on his face? He was happy. He was very, very happy. He was excited because he knew that when he went to go talk to the king, he was going to have the answer. He knew that this was going to be a blessing. I mean, tremendous blessing for him, but also for the king. It's like when you see a good movie. You're just so excited to go share with everybody about this great movie, or you read a great book, or you went to a restaurant, you know, and you start telling everybody about the restaurant that you went to. I mean, they're not even paying you to advertise. You're just telling people about it. You know, you're doing it for free because God has given you something and you like to share it with other people. Well, that's the same thing with the wisdom of God. That's the same thing with the Word of God. I mean, I get so excited. I love most of my, you know, Christian life up to the last few years. I never got paid for it, but I wanted to share with people the things that God has put in my life. It made me happy. It blessed me. And so Daniel and his friends are happy. Now, let's pick it up in verse 45. He explains it to the king. And he says, "The great God has shown the king what will take place in the future. The dream is true and its interpretation is trustworthy." So now just picture this. He has just dumped this whole thing on the king. His dream, the interpretation, what it means. And then it says, "Then King Nebuchadnezzar," the most powerful man on the planet, "fell prostrate." I mean, face forward, before Daniel and paid him honor. Remember, Daniel is a slave, and yet this king, because of the power and the glory of God, hits the pavement, and he ordered an offering of incense to be presented to Daniel. The king said to Daniel, "Surely your God is the God of gods and the Lord of kings and the revealer of mysteries, for you were able to reveal this mystery." Now look what happened. Who got the glory for this? God himself got the glory. When the body is working the way it's supposed to, God will receive the glory. Then the king placed Daniel in a high position. This is a guy, he didn't even know his name before he showed up. And now he's being placed in a high position, lavished many gifts on him. He made him ruler over the entire province of Babylon and placed him in charge of all his wise men. Moreover, at Daniel's request, the king appointed Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the administrators over the province of Babylon, while Daniel himself remained at the royal courts. Now, there is not a problem in your life that God can't give you wisdom, or look at an impossible situation in your life as an opportunity for dramatic change. Now, I want you to stop and think as we get ready to close here. Maybe there's a situation in your heart, there's a situation in your life that you're going through, and you really need the power of God, the wisdom of God to come through. God created this whole situation with King Nebuchadnezzar. He knew about the dream. As a matter of fact, he gave Nebuchadnezzar the dream. He knew that Nebuchadnezzar was going to have this hostile view to the wise men about getting the answer to this dream. And he knew that he was going to give Daniel the interpretation, the revelation, and God knew that Nebuchadnezzar would place him in this high position. Every mountain in your life can be an opportunity for God to be glorified, for God to be able to expand the boundaries as we test him in faith. So don't think the trials that you may be going through in your life are by accident, or woe is me. You see, when you have the wisdom and the knowledge of God, you'll know that he's going to make all things work together for good. Amen? And he is going to bring glory to himself, and he is going to bless you in the process. Let's go ahead and stand together. We're going to close in prayer. If you have an issue in your life, if you don't know this King of Glory, if you don't know the wise giver of all things, he is the one that'll make you, he'll give you life, he'll give you peace, he'll give you joy. If you have a need in your heart, before we close, there's something pressing on your heart that you need prayer for. Maybe there's a mountain that you need wisdom. Let me give you a moment or two before we close to be able to pray with you. If you need prayer, please come forward before we close.